In the last two videos, I've been discussing outliers. First, I showed you how to use one of the most common and robust measures of outliers to identify and even remove those outliers from an Excel dataset. And cooler still, I even showed you how to remove them from a pivot table summary beneath. That was a Tukey method, which uses quartiles in the interquartile range to identify outliers. Then in the last video, I covered three other methods of outlier detection or removal: the trim, mean, standard Z-score, and modified Z-score methods. I also rounded things off a little bit by going into some more depth about outliers, how to detect them, when to remove them, and why outlier detection can be very valuable. So if you haven't watched those, make sure to go back and check them out. Now in this video, I actually want to go into Excel and figure out how we can identify those outliers using the three methods I mentioned from the last video. Hey everyone, and welcome back to the Engineering Toolbox channel, where I give you the tools you need to solve real-world engineering problems. So in the first video, we got up to this point where we identified outliers using the Tukey method. But now let's look at the three other methods that I discussed and compare the results. So first was the trim mean method, so we'll add a column for that. And in order to calculate this, we'll have to use the trim mean function. And we'll also make this an array function, so we're going to use an if statement to say if this part number is equal to this array of parts, then we're going to look at this array of values. And then the false will just enter a blank value because it should always be true. And then the percent we'll use is 10%, so 0.1. And 10% is a pretty typical value, but you might also want to use 20% or something like that. That might be a bit extreme depending on your sample size, but we'll hit Control Shift Enter to make that an array function. You'll notice these little brackets. So let's take a look at the pivot table of this. We'll refresh our data so everything is up to date. And then we'll drop in the trim mean value and make that an average. And just for comparison, let's look at the hours per part. We'll take the average of that. So this will be the original mean. And we can see that they're pretty much the same, except for this one value. So that was the only case where it took out some values in order to give us a trim mean. The reason it only affected this part number is because we used a value of 10% for our trim percentage. That means it takes off 5% of the count, or 5% of the samples from both ends of the distribution. So this part number was the only one that had more than 20 samples. So 5% of 20 is 1. So that means it takes off one value from each end. If it's less than 20, it actually rounds down, so it won't actually trim any values. All right, next let's look at the standard Z-score method for detecting outliers. So standard Z-score, we'll add a column. And for this, we're actually going to add another column, and this is going to be the standard deviation. And the standard deviation is used to calculate a Z value. So we'll need to calculate that first. And we're going to use an array method. We're going to say standard deviation, and we'll want, there's two here. This is for the population standard deviation. This is for the sample standard deviation. We're going to use the sample. And then we'll do the standard deviation if, same thing, we're going to match our part number to the array. The value of true is going to be our part values, blank for false, Control Shift Enter. Oops, missing a parenthesis. Okay, there we go. This is going to be the standard deviation for each part number. We'll also need to add in the mean, so the original mean or average. This is going to be average, then if this part number equals the array, then use the hours per part array. Value of false is blank, close off the average, hit Control Shift Enter. So now that we have a standard deviation and mean, we can calculate the standard Z-score. And the Z-score is calculated with this equation. Basically, we're finding out how many standard deviations are there between a given sample and the median or mean of that sample. So we could just enter in or set up an equation manually, but Excel also has a built-in function for calculating this. So we can say equals standardize, find the X value for that sample, compare that to the mean of all the samples, and then feed the function the standard deviation for the samples. And then when we hit enter there, we get our Z-score values. So if you remember from the last video then, I said that we can determine outliers by using the Z-score and setting a limit for the number of standard deviations that we're allowing data to be considered non-outliers. So I said we could use plus or minus 2, 2.5, or 3 standard deviations or Z-score values. So let's just use 3 as our limit on the z-score value. So let's say z-score outlier. We'll add a column for that. Then we'll just set up an if statement. Say if the absolute value of this is greater than 3, then true. And if not, then false. So now we can go back to our pivot table and see how the mean changes whether or not we include z outliers. So let's just kind of copy and paste these down to so we can compare things. So this is the original mean. Original mean. And then we'll say trimmed mean. And now if we add a slicer to our pivot table to look at z outlier values, we only want to look at values that are false. So if we basically exclude any z outliers, we can compare those values to our original mean. So there's our original mean. Here is our mean with the z outliers excluded. And then let's actually add in the Tukey outliers just so we can compare that as well. So for Tukey outliers, add that in there. And we want those to be false and that to be true. So let's look at what that looks like. So now we can start to see how each method returns different results. So now let's look at the last method, which is going to be the modified z-score. This one is tricky, but it's pretty robust. So this is one of my favorites. It works pretty well for small sample sizes, and it ends up returning similar results to the Tukey method as well, because it uses median values to determine outliers. So we're going to need to add two columns here. We're going to say the MAD and modified z-score. So the MAD is going to be the median absolute deviation of each data point from the median. So that's kind of hard to explain. So I'm actually going to add another column, which will hopefully make it a little bit easier to understand. So this is going to be the median, or actually the absolute median deviation. So now this value is going to be the difference from our data point and the sample median. So we'll add that. Actually, sorry, that's the absolute value of that. So we're not concerned with direction, we're just concerned with how far our data point is from the sample median. And the MAD then is going to be another array function. We're going to take the median of these values. We'll go quartile just because I like to use that formula. And then this will be another array function. So we'll say if this part number matches the part array again, then we're going to look to our absolute deviation values. If not nothing, close off the if statement and then tell the quartile function which quartile we're looking at, and that's the second quartile for the median. Then hit Control Shift Enter for that, and this is our median absolute deviation. So this tells us how far each data point is from the median. So in order to calculate the modified z-score now, if we look back at our formula from our last video here, the modified z-score equals this constant times the difference between the data sample and the sample median divided by the MAD. Let's build this formula into our table here. We'll say 0.64 or 6745 times the difference of our data sample and our median, quartile 2, and then all of that divided by the MAD. And then if we hit enter there, these are going to be the values for a modified z-score. And the last thing we need to do is add the column to say if it is a mod z-score outlier. So we'll add a column here, say mod z outlier. We'll write a quick if statement to say if the absolute value of this is greater than 3.5 is typically the value used as the threshold for outliers when using the modified z-score method. So if it is greater than 3.5, then we're going to return true to say yes, it is an outlier, and if not, false, it is not an outlier. And then now we have identified our mod z outliers. So we can go to our pivot table quick and take this filter off, refresh our data here. We want to add a slicer here so we can filter out the false values or the true values to filter out the outliers. So we'll just select just the false. Here is the mean after modified z outliers have been removed. So there are our results. So I'm sure some of you might have been wondering why we were using array functions. They can be a little bit tricky, but the reason we need to use them is because we're trying to summarize our data by part number to to get an average excluding these certain outliers. That was kind of the overall goal of this, just to kind of compare the different methods and see what they do for identifying outliers, how they change the mean, things like that. And then one other note, just be cautious of using these array functions in large data sets. They're very nice because we can kind of aggregate data by a different, you know, a category here like we did for the part numbers. But if this were a really long list of part numbers, definitely a lot bigger than this, I'm talking in like the thousands, it would really slow down the calculations that Excel has to do in order to calculate our values. So just be cautious of that. I've had spreadsheets before in the past that are in the thousands of part numbers, and it really gets bogged down, so just be cautious.
All right, I hope you all enjoyed that one. To get more videos as they are released, make sure to hit that subscribe button. If you like this video, make sure to like and share, and if you didn't like it, well, then leave me a comment and let me know how I can improve. Last but not least, this channel is for you, so if you have any suggestions for topics you want me to cover, make sure to let me know. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.